Listening Library presents Royal Scandal by Amy Carter. Read for you by Kristen Sieh. To Malcolm. Chapter 1. We at the Regal Record hope you've been good this year, because it seems like St. Nicholas has come early for us all. Despite rumours of a cancellation thanks to an untimely blizzard across the pond, the United Kingdom's notoriously naughty royal family will indeed be hosting a state banquet tonight for the President of the United States, Hope Park, and it promises to be chock full of chaos. Under ordinary circumstances, this state visit would be noteworthy, considering President Park is both the first woman and first Korean-American to hold the highest office in the US. But just like every other significant event as of late, this historic achievement has already been overshadowed by the most recent addition to the House of Windsor's royal family tree. That's right, Evangeline Bright, the King's illegitimate American daughter, will be in attendance tonight. And given her past exploits, it's safe to assume she'll do something gratingly inept to steal the thunder and the headlines from those who've actually earned their place at the royal table. In the 5.5 months since Evangeline's tasteless and explosive BBC One interview, detailing her own sordid behaviour that led directly to Jasper Cunningham's death, of which she was cleared of criminal charges, thanks to a reported backroom deal between Scotland Yard and the King's personal lawyers, the palace has seen fit to shove her down the throats of the British people at seemingly every turn. Hospital openings, charity appearances, even walkabouts typically reserved for legitimate members of the royal family. Evangeline has merrily joined in on all, resulting in a long list of missteps and blunders. Yet despite the efforts of the palace to make her palatable, it's becoming painfully clear that no amount of media and etiquette training can turn this American frog into a princess. How much longer can the royal family's already tattered reputation withstand the bright blight? While we wait to see the fallout of tonight's state banquet and Evangeline's inevitable indiscretions, we at the Regal Record can only apologise yet again for revealing her identity this summer and unleashing this Pandora's box of mayhem and vexation on not only the entire country, but the world. One must own up to one's mistakes, and we deeply regret our part in this royal fiasco. Let us hope that no one else ends up dead tonight. The Regal Record, 18th of December, 2023. I'm well aware that being on time isn't a priority for you, says Tibby, clutching her phone like she's about to chuck it at my tiara. But could you at least pretend to care that I'm about to lose my bloody job? I'm leaning against the wall in the long gallery of Windsor Castle, trying to keep my head upright as I fiddle with a strap on my stiletto. My gown isn't making it any easier, and as I set my foot down, the heel snags and comes dangerously close to ripping the shimmering burgundy fabric. It's my shoe, I mutter, untangling my hem. One of the straps is loose. Tibby arches an eyebrow as I test my weight again. Somehow, despite what has been an obscenely long day full of trivial appointments and last-minute fittings, Lady Tabitha Finch Parker Covington Boyle's black pixie cut is still perfectly styled, and her tailored gray dress doesn't have a single piece of lint on it. Unfortunately for both of us, this superpower has yet to rub off on me in the 6 months she's been my personal secretary slash babysitter, and no one is more aggrieved by my failure to develop a completely new personality than Tibby. I don't care if the heel's broken off and you're walking on your tiptoes, she says. We cannot be late, Evan. We're not late. As I resume my march down the corridor, now with a noticeably uneven gait, I glance through the nearest window and into the dark courtyard beyond. A line of luxury vehicles snakes along the opposite wing of Windsor Castle, and royal footmen hoist umbrellas as tonight's guests exit their cars and step into the December downpour. Okay, we're a little late, but
there is no such thing as a little late, says Tibby.
If His Majesty discovers you're missing, it'll be my neck on the block, not yours. He'll be too busy with the president to notice. Besides, they don't need me for the pictures, and I'm not escorting anyone inside.
An unforgivable oversight,
says Tibby irritably, as if this too is somehow my fault. You're His Majesty's daughter and you're American. You should be in the procession, preferably on the arm of a member of the President's family. Your absence will only start another wave of rumours in the press. I start rumours by breathing, I say. Besides, it'd be an insult to pair me with anyone important. Tibby sniffs. Illegitimate or not, you're still of royal blood. Which is the only reason I'm part of this dog and pony show in the first place, I say. That and the fact that the universe has a terrible sense of humor. By the time we turn the corner and pass the royal family's private apartments, my scalp is throbbing. I reach up to adjust the Queen Florence tiara that's secured to my braided updo. But before my fingers can even graze the glittering headpiece, Tibby swats my hand away. Don't you dare, she says with more vehemence than usual. Can you imagine the headlines if your tiara falls off in front of the royal rota? The metaphor alone. The pins are digging in, I protest. I think my scalp might actually be bleeding. Ignore it. The banquet won't last more than 3 or 4 hours. 3 or 4? I gape at her. Haven't you people ever heard of the Geneva Conventions? You're royalty, darling, she says in the dismissive tone she always uses when I complain. The Geneva Conventions don't apply. I start to object, but before I can utter more than a single syllable, Tibby turns on her heel to face me and I stumble to a halt. I understand you're uncomfortable, Evan, she says, her voice low and hurried. I understand you'd rather not sit around for hours listening to a bunch of politicians make each other feel important. But this is the price you pay for being royal. This is the price you pay for living in a castle with a staff of hundreds to cater to your whims. You have every resource you could ever need, every opportunity you could ever dream of, and you are one of the most famous people in the world. You are privileged in a way damn few others are, and if you tell me one more time how uncomfortable your designer shoes and couture gown and priceless tiara are, I will throttle you. For a long moment, we stare at each other in silence. She's right, of course. Every word of it. And I hate that 6 months ago, I would have throttled myself for acting like this, too. Sorry, I mumble, my cheeks growing warm. I think I'm spending too much time around Maisie. Her Royal Highness's faults are no excuse for yours, says Tibby tartly. But at last she steps aside, and we continue down the hall toward the state apartments. The people are watching you, Evan, and they deserve more than another ungrateful brat. Especially when you offer them hope that maybe their lives can become a fairy tale too. I snort. Being accused of murder and having all my secrets exposed to the entire world counts as a fairy tale now? Haven't you read the Brothers Grimm? Says Tibby. Murder is practically a plot requirement. If we want any chance of making it in time, we'll have to go this way. She ushers me into the royal family's private chapel. Sacrilegious, I'm sure, though clearly the only sin Tibby's worried about is tardiness. She's moving so quickly now that I'm forced to do a strange skip to keep up. But when we finally reach the threshold of St. George's Hall, I stop in my tracks, and so does she. While normally the vast hall is empty, save for the ever-present paintings, marble busts, and suits of armor that line the walls, a table that easily seats 200 now stretches from one end to the other, covered in massive festive bouquets and more plates and utensils than I've ever seen. And because my life, while newly charmed, can never be fair, nearly all of tonight's guests are already inside as a fleet of footmen show them to their seats. Tibby swears. Keep your head up, but move quickly, she whispers. And this time I don't complain as we hurry to the nearest exit. Before we make it more than 20 feet, however, a woman at the end of the table gasps. Evangeline, she says, her voice mercifully low. A few of her companions turn to look at me too, and I smile and press my finger to my lips. Her shock quickly turns to conspiratorial amusement, and even though I'm not a princess, or even an official member of the royal family, she dips in a low curtsy. A rising murmur follows Tibby and me now, and I do my best to walk properly in my uncooperative shoe, keenly aware of all the eyes on us. It's only sheer luck that I don't trip and fall on my face, and when we finally reach the nearest exit,
Tibby all but yanks me through the doorway and straight into the middle of an explosion of camera flashes.
"Ah, Evangeline,"
says a deep voice as the door closes behind us. I'm pleased.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.